is educated at Stonyhurst College in Lancashire, source of all good things, and then at St. John's College in Oxford. And it was while at Oxford that Nick decided to join the Jesuits, which was a change from his initial ambition to become a barrister. After completing his novitiate, he went on to study philosophy and theology at Heathrow College, London, and then did postgraduate studies in early Judaism at the Oriental Institute in Oxford. Education really has been his life, teaching both at school and university level. In 1989, he was invited to take up a position of Dean of Studies in a Centre for the Education of New Clergy in Pretoria, and he remained in South Africa for 12 years and served as a district observer for 7 polling stations in the Natal Midlands for the 2 days of the first democratic elections in South Africa in April 1994. And he describes his South African experience as affecting both his life and his faith. On his return to Britain, he took up a teaching post at Oxford University, where he now teaches in the Department of New Testament Studies. He's the author of a number of works, including in 1995 a book called Setting the Gospel Free, which is a scriptural approach to liberation theology set in the context of South Africa, and in 1998 a book entitled Whispers of Liberation, about feminist perspectives on the New Testament. In 2004, Nick published his own translation of the New Testament with an interactive commentary, and he's now working solely, I understand, on a translation of the Greek version of the Hebrew scriptures of the Old Testament. And he's currently chair of the Catholic Biblical Association. He's always been a keen sportsman, playing both squash and cricket, which he also taught. No longer quite as active as he once was, he is now the senior member of the University Squash Club in Oxford, which he says means benevolently attending meetings and matches and ponderously hinting at past glories. I'm sure there'll be nothing ponderous about his input to us tonight. His topic is the Gospel of Mark, under the intriguing title of Mark, the Strangest Gospel, which is also the title of another of his publications. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to introduce Father Nick King.
So I'm talking about Mark's Gospel, and it's the Strangest Gospel. We're going to stop at 6, because I know you've all got to rush off to libraries and things like that, so it's writing on Wednesday afternoon. What do you know about Mark's Gospel? Has anyone heard of Mark's Gospel? Okay, what have you heard about it?
It's a gospel.
It's a gospel. Okay, well, so where would you find it? Your tutor tells you to go out and find your gospel. Yeah, New Testament Bible. Anything else known about Mark's Gospel?
It was done as a play, wasn't it? A narrative.
They used my...
No?
Alec from Carmen did that. Yeah, that's right. Anything else? Have you heard of Mark's Gospel? Yeah.
It's the shortest.
It's the shortest. Best reason for starting with it.
It's probably the first written of it.
Certainly the first written. I am almost certain of that. Now, there are a few people who would argue that Matthew came first. I don't believe all of it. I don't see how Mark could do anything but the first. So he invented the Gospel form. Now, here's the thing. It's a story. Point one on your sheet. Why did they do it as a story? Why don't they write our theological narrative, our foundation, why did they write it as a story, not a theological treatise? It's supposed to be theology, isn't it? Why do you think they do it? Imagine you are Mark. Why do you write a story? Stories are easy to remember. Do you remember when you were a child and you were in bed at night and your parents came up and said, "Once upon a time"? Yeah. And what a magic moment that was for you. Because why is it a magic moment? What's so important about story? Yeah.
I'm sorry. What's important about story?
Why do you think a story is important?
Because it allows your imagination.
Yeah, the imagination works, doesn't it? And the thing about a story is, it invites you aboard. Do you remember the first time you went to the pantomime And you were told that when the demon king came on, you would know who he was because he had a moustache. And there were green lights and he was cracking a whip, so it's easy to tell when there are demons. And you remember you were told to boo when he came on board. And so you knew where you were. Really, really important moment. Bad people do bad things, good people do good things, and the good are rewarded and the bad get punished. That's the story world, and it's not a bad world. Does Mark's gospel do that, do you think? Is the story of Jesus, does it have a happy ending or an unhappy ending? What do you think? Happy. Why? Because Jesus is resurrected. Now, there's an old thing about Mark's gospel.
Well, that's very inconclusive, though. It's a very inconclusive ending.
It's a very old ending. In fact, point four, if we get there, a very astonishing, and you use the word abrupt, and you're quite right. Yeah. But let's have a look at the beginning, which I think, and I've called it the Strangest Gospel. I've done something intelligent with my glasses, because when you get to my age, you can't find your glasses because you can't see. Yeah, sometimes I can find the thing that pulls them, and not... Right, this is the beginning of Mark's Gospel, possibly the title of it. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Messiah, Son of God. When Mark's hearers, they weren't readers, they were hearers. He was writing for it to be performed through people's ears. When they heard that word beginning, what bells might that have rung? Remember another text that begins with the beginning? Yeah. The book of Genesis, the very first word of the Bible, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So, quite clearly, Mark is writing for that sort of person. People for whom what we call the Old Testament, they didn't call it the Old Testament, is part of the background. Okay, the beginning of the good news. What's good news? That's the second word of Mark's Gospel. I tell you the Greek for it. The Greek for it is euangelio, which goes into Latin as evangelio. Gives you the English word evangelical. Though it goes by another route into Anglo-Saxon as Godspell, and what does the word Godspell turn into in our version of English? Gospel. Yeah. So it's good news, whichever way you track it. But originally, a euangelion was the reward that you were given if you carried the good news to the Senate that the emperor had won a victory over the fuzzy wuzzies out there in Partha or Media or somewhere like that. So you've got a nice chunk of money. Or if Mrs. Emperor had the good sense to produce a male child, you went along to the Senate and they reward you with a euangelion, a drop of money. Don't ask what happened if you brought bad news to the Senate. If you want some advice when you're starting out on your post-war career, don't bring bad news to the Senate. It might bring your career to a rapid end. So that's the background. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Messiah. So who's going? Imagine you're in a bookshop, not in Europe probably, but Antioch or Rome or Ephesus or something like that. Who's going to buy this in a bookshop?
Listen, that's really a point one, you're all right.
Yep. Who's going to buy that book, would you think? The beginning of the good news of Jesus Messiah. Do you think?
Who?
Would you buy that book? Why not? Okay. She's actually said something quite important because most people for whom Mark was writing couldn't read and they would hear it. So it was a trick question. You don't go into a bookshop and buy it. It's kept by a community. What kind of a community would keep this? Yeah. What we call the early Christian community. That's right. Mark's church, to use a... So they would keep that, and we'll come back to that point later on. Which we may not, because we've got to stop eventually. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah. And then Mark does something quite extraordinary, because he gives a quotation. This is the quotation. Look, I am sending my angel, or my messenger, before your face, who's going to prepare your way. But if you knew your Bible terribly well, you would all be leaping up from the seat and saying, as one member of the audience, that's not from Isaiah. And you are of course, quite right. You were about to say that, weren't you?
Yes.
Yeah, it's not from Isaiah, it's from Isaiah. So there's all malachy, depending on which way you look at it. And then Mark gets back on track and produces something from from Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths. And that is Isaiah. So who is the gospel about? Do you think? I mean, normally, who is a gospel about? This is not a trick question. Jesus, yes, we know that. So you think the hero of this gospel is going to be Jesus. So now maybe we're going to meet Jesus. What happens? There came John the Baptizer in the desert, and he was proclaiming a baptism of repentance for forgiveness of sins. Now, you are Mark. Why do you start your gospel talking not about Jesus, but about this hairy character called John the Baptist? Thought?
Does this have any comparison? So if you start with something that we understand, and then we see how great
whatever it is. That's right. It's a comparison, and Jesus, he's going to show, is much greater than John the Baptist. Why did he have to talk about John the Baptist? What did John the Baptist do? Yes. What does his name suggest? And he baptized. That's right. Whom, among others, did he baptize? He baptized Jesus. Now, isn't that an extraordinary thing? You can bet your bottom dollar that disciples of John the Baptist, and they were still around. Acts chapter 18 mentions them. You can bet your bottom dollar that they were saying, our man is more important than your man, to the Christians. Our man baptized your man. He's got to be more important. And each of the four Gospels have their own different answer to that question. But all of them want to say, no, actually Jesus is more important than John the Baptist. But the four answers are quite different. Okay, so he's in the desert, he's proclaiming a baptism, and there went out to him the whole of the Judean region and all the Jerusalemites. So this evening, there isn't a single soul in Jerusalem. Go and check now. Sorry. You're very welcome. And on that seat, well, there were on that seat some notes. We're still only on point one, so there's no crisis. Actually, now we've reached point two, I think. And they were being baptized and confessing their sins, and John, and now we hear John's clothing, his wardrobe. It's not exactly, is Gucci a clothing firm? Or is it just handbag? I don't know. Anyway, it's not whatever. He was wearing camel hair. And you're supposed to shout yuck at that. And a leather girdle, really, around his unmentionables. And he was, and now we hear his diet, locusts and wild honey. Are you filled with enthusiasm to see John Lennon? He looks like a Yeti. And now we're getting to it. And he was proclaiming, saying, there is coming one bigger than me after me. Who is the one? Not bigger than me, stronger than me. Who's the one stronger than me? Jesus. That's right. So you see we're getting there, but how slowly we're getting there. And it's deliberate. Mark makes us wait. And he says, I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. Now the rabbis said that undoing someone's sandals because of what was on the ground in a busy city, which I won't put you off your supper by mentioning, was so disgusting that not even a slave should be asked to do that. And John is said to be saying, I'm not even fit to do that for this strong one, who is, of course, Jesus. I baptize you with water. He's going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. And then at last erupts onto the stage this extraordinary character whom we've been waiting for. And you see how Mark has kept us waiting. By the way, the reason I'm talking about Mark is that this year most of the Christian churches on Sunday are reading Mark's Gospel. So I want you to remember this stuff each Sunday when you hear it read to you. And just check out with your pastor or minister or priest and say, do you think it's a strange gospel? And there came in those, and it happened in those days that there came Jesus from Nazareth. And you're all supposed to say, from where? You can't get more obscure from Nazareth. Even today, it's a pretty crowded city. There's only one word in the whole of Nazareth. And it's way in our country, Galilee, where no one ever goes. So from Nazareth of Galilee, and he was baptized into the Jordan by John. So there's Mark's way of coping with it. He takes the bull by the horns and he admits it. You read the other three Gospels, and they handle it in a quite different way. So he's baptized into the Jordan by John, and immediately, now if tonight you'll do the favor of reading through the first two chapters of Mark's Gospel, because you've all got your Bibles at home, haven't you? Not many of you have got them here, but you will. Read it through and count the number of times that adverb immediately or straight away appears, and you will be astonished. And the effect is to give a kind of breathlessness to the narrative of Mark's story. And immediately, coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens being torn open. Now, you won't believe this, but some translations go so medium-up at that point that they say the heavens were open. No, that is not what Mark wrote. They were torn open. Who tears the heavens open? God. It's quite clearly the work of God. But you see how he doesn't need to say it, and how the reader immediately picks up the clues there. God, this is a God story. If it's a God story, then extraordinary things, quite extraordinary things, are going to happen. And he saw the Spirit coming down upon him, and a voice came from the heavens. Whose voice?
God's.
You're learning. And now, if it's the voice of God, then the rules of the game are it's going to tell the truth. And listen to what it says. You are my son, the beloved, and you I am well pleased. Who's that addressed to? Interesting, when you look at Matthew's Gospel, that's another thing you can do tonight, join the adverts of the television or halftime during the football match. Look at what Matthew does, and he's changed it. I mean, he's got Mark's Gospel open in front of him. He's changed it to, this is my son. So it's become a public affirmation. In Mark, it's just for Jesus. Jesus knows. And you and I know, because Mark allows us to know the story. We're meant to listen to that. And then one more. I mean, I could come on forever about the beginning, but we've got to get to the end, haven't we? So just two more words. And immediately, have we heard that adverb before? Yes, we jolly well have. And immediately, the Spirit hurls him out into the desert. Now, look at your translation tonight, and you'll see that a lot of translations again go very mealy-mouthed at that point. They say something like, sends him out, or gives him a bus to get out. Hurls him out into the desert. So the Spirit, whom we've just seen hovering over him like a dove. What does that remind us of, by the way? The Spirit hovering like a dove? The Holy Spirit, yes, clearly, but? Yes, although we haven't forgotten about Pentecost yet. Yeah, you got it?
Yes,
see? What did the dove do in Noah's Ark?
Goes to find dry land.
That's right, and sometimes it fails to find and comes back, and then it disappears, and yeah, that's right. So it's that kind of a dove. And by the way, the prophet Jonah, who produced our first reading last Sunday, his name means dove, and there's something in that, but we won't go down that road because it's a long, boring passage. And the Spirit hurls him out into the desert, where John the Baptist has just been, and he was in the desert for 40 days. What echo is meant to be run there with the 40 days in the desert? Yeah, go on. Noah's Ark. In one version, it's got two different sums in the book of Genesis. One's 150 days and one's 40. But 40 is something, have you got?
There's also 40 days in the wilderness.
40 days?
40 years.
40 chronological units? You know what?
40 years.
40 years.
The Israelites.
The Israelites. So you see, you've got Jesus being, and he's being John the Baptist, because John the Baptist was out in the desert. Now he's being the Israelites. And he is being tempted by the Satan. You remember Matthew and Luke have big threefold temptation. This is just, he was tempted. No story about what he was tempted to do. No story either about whether the Satan was successful or a failure. What's your guess?
A failure.
That Satan was a failure and didn't manage to tempt Jesus. But just notice it. And he was with the wild beasts. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Wild beasts? Huh? On the whole, lions and tigers and that sort of thing, a bit uncomfortable. So for most of the time, I think, yes, that's quite an uncomfortable place to be. But just think of this. In the stuff about Messiah in Isaiah 11, and the new world he's going to create, he says the lion will lie down like the lamb, and mothers shudder at this, the infant play over the cobra's hole, and the child shall lead a little bear. So it might be Mark saying, well, actually, this new world has come, or it might be, no, this is Frank. And notice that Mark is not telling us, you and I have to work it out. So it's a very strange beginning. And one last piece of strangeness, and the angels were serving him. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? It's a very good thing. And serving is a really important word in Mark's Gospel. It doesn't appear very often, just four times. It appears here, the angel serving Jesus. In Mark 1:29, you've got Simon Peter's mother-in-law at Capernaum. And Jesus goes and cures her. Now, not everyone is ecstatic with gratitude when your mother-in-law is cured. We're not told what Simon Peter's all about. But when she is cured, and she's got a fever, in that pre-antibiotics world, that means she's probably dying. The fever, Jesus goes in, presumably into the women's quarters, where he has no right to be, and touches her, which he shouldn't do, because she's a woman and might be impure, and she's possibly a corpse and might be impure, and he touches her. And the fever disappears, and then she gets up and serves. And it was the feminist scholar said, there you are, typical men exploiting the women, forcing them to labor. But actually, no, we're meant to stand back and applaud this great woman who serves. Then the next time we hear it is in chapter 10, when, do you remember, James and John wanted a blank check for Jesus, from Jesus. Master, we want you to do something for us. Well, what do you want? We want to play inside right and inside left in your football team. Quite like that, we want to sit on the left side. And then the other guys hear this and they get cross, the other ten. And Jesus says, no, you go. No. The Son of Man, that's Jesus. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So service is a really important value in this gospel. And it's what disciples are meant to do. And then the last time it's used, God bless them, the women. The women in Mark's gospel, read it tonight, it'll only take you about 40 minutes. The women, with one and a half exceptions, always get it right in Mark's Gospel. The women are always right, and right at the end, when all the male disciples have fled, saying, bye, Jesus, hope you'll be all right, we're just off now. The women are there at the cross, looking from a long way off, but they're there. And Mark says of them, they had been with him, following, which is Mark's key word for discipleship, and serving him. So we're meant to congratulate those women. Right, sorry, we're going to catch up. By the way, any questions so far? Are you all serving? So next I want to go to the very middle of the Gospel. And if you count the number of words in the Gospel, this is the very middle. You can do that tonight too. You want to do something? Luckily you've got no essays on hand. So this is the very middle of the Gospel. And in an ancient manuscript, there's nothing such thing as chapter and verse. So one of the ways in which you learn how to read it is look at the structure, and they would easily know where you are in the middle. Very important though. So this is the very middle. And Jesus went out and his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he was interrogating his disciples, saying to them, who do people say I am? And then they try on various hats, and they try a few vaguely religious hats to fit on him to see if they'll fit. So they said, one says John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others say one of the prophets. So fairly harmless religious categories. But notice what it's doing. It's making you, the reader, or rather the hearer, think, wait a minute, who is this Jesus? Because that's what you're supposed to do all the time, all the way through Mark's Gospel. He's trying to answer two questions. Question one, we've looked at a bit, and we're looking at it here. Who is Jesus? Question two, this is where you come in. If Jesus is like this, then what must his disciples be like? So those two questions, and here they come extraordinarily together. So he asked them, and you, what about you, who do you say I am? And God bless him, Peter speaks up, impetuous always, and very often gets it right. He says to him, you're the Messiah. And that's come from a clear sky, because the word Messiah hasn't been mentioned since the first line of the Gospel, and Peter hasn't read that. So we applaud Peter. But then something very odd happens, and he rebuked them to say nothing about him. Why? Why does Jesus... I mean, is Peter right? Is Jesus the Messiah? The Christ? Yeah. So why does he say, now look, you're not to tell anyone about him?
Because all the nutters have come
out. Because all the nutters. Yeah, there is a touch of that. I think there may be another little bit to it. Can anyone see a reason why Jesus might not want it to be known that he is the Messiah? His time hasn't come yet. He says that, doesn't he, in John's Gospel to his mother. I think that's one way of putting it. Any other thoughts on it?
Humility?
Yeah, it could be just straight humility, and it's often read that way. Notice also that it might be dangerous, because the nearest the Romans could get to talking about the Messiah would be king, and it's actually as king that he's eventually crucified by Pontius Pilate. And the other thing is, his own people might misunderstand, because one characteristic view of the Messiah is that he's going to ride in on a white horse and send those Romans crashing into the sea, and Jesus is not that kind of Messiah. He's a Messiah that's going to die, and that's what comes out at this point. So he began to teach them that the Son of Man, that's him, has to suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. That's the entire religious establishment. The Pope, the cardinals, the canonical monsignores, and the provincials of the Carmelites. Or something like that. And be killed, and after 3 days, we never noticed this, after 3 days, rise again. And he spoke this word confidently. Now listen to this. And Peter, remember, Peter has just got it right. He said, yes, you're the Messiah. Peter now says, if I can find the place. I had it a second. Oh, here we are. Yes, and Peter took hold of him. Now you shouldn't do that, really. And began to rebuke him. And that is not on. That's not Peter's position. And he turned round, notice this, and seeing the disciples, said, rebuked Peter and says, get behind me, Satan. I mean, that's extraordinary strong language, isn't it? Right at the center of the gospel. So here's Peter. He's got Jesus right, and we were just applauding him a minute ago, because he said, yes, you're the Messiah. But what's he got wrong? Why is he suddenly be called Satan?
He had a very human view of what happened.
And what, yeah, go on, what's the human view that he's got?
So he said to Jesus, I don't know.
Yeah. Anyone else? You're nearly there. What's he got wrong, Peter?
Jesus is supposed to
be bringing
power.
Yeah, that's right. He thinks he's going to come on this white horse or driving his tank. But no, this is a Messiah who's going to die. And that's terribly, terribly important in this gospel. And then, remember the second question is, what are disciples like? Summoning the crowd with his disciples. Sorry, get behind me, Satan, because you're not thinking God thoughts, you're thinking human thoughts. And by the way, get behind isn't necessarily go away, I'd never want to see you again. Get behind is what you say to someone who's going to be a disciple. You follow after Jesus. Then he summoned the crowds with his disciples. Now you've got to listen to this, because this is addressed out of these pages at you in York in 2012. He summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if any of you want to come after me, to follow behind me, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. So that's the answer to your second question. What are disciples? They're people who are going to follow Jesus and prepare to go the way he goes. I wish I could show you the examples in the gospel that are there. Bartimaeus is one. We might come back to Bartimaeus later on if you ever ask a question. So that's the middle of the gospel. I want to come sort of to the end. And one of the things about the end of Mark's gospel is that it's very, very gloomy. You've got the Last Supper. Now, have any of you been with Jewish friends to a Passover celebration? Yeah. One or two of you have. It's a wonderful occasion. because you're celebrating the liberation from Egypt. So it's the great feast of the Jewish year. If ever you get an invitation from Jewish friends, make sure you accept it. Clear your diary for that. It's a wonderful, wonderful occasion. So we're sitting back and watching, and Jesus has made a coded arrangement with someone to celebrate the Passover. The disciples know nothing about it, but Jerusalem is terribly crowded at Passover festival. It is today, and it was in Jesus' day. So he's made an arrangement, he's got an upper room already. And so they come along, they're really excited, this is a Passover, and they can tell something's going to happen. Something always does happen at Passover in Jerusalem. He sits down with them. And instead of reading the story of the liberation from Egypt, or getting the youngest of them to ask the questions, he says, any of you remember how he starts off the Last Supper?
Passover.
Ah, that's in John's Gospel. He does, and that's very important. But alas, we can't talk about John. But you're quite right.
Is he
going to
throw it over the betrayal?
Yes. One of you, he says, is going to betray me. One of you was eating with me. And you've got to understand, in that culture, and it's still true today in the Arab world, if you approach a Bedouin camp from the east or from the north or the south, then they are in duty bound to greet you, welcome you, ask after your work, your children, your camels, and finally your wives, sit you down and have a meal with you, and then you are bound to each other for life. And then when you've had a meal, then he says, now what can I do for you? So the very idea that anyone who shared a meal like that would betray is just horrifying. And you can feel in the Gospels the horror that people experience at the idea of betrayal. And so if you read, I won't read it to you now, if you read that account of Mark, it's very brief, of the Last Supper, you can just feel the shadow falling over where no shadow should be. It should be a great occasion, and Jesus has blown it. One of you is going to betray me. But fortunately, we know that it's true. So then he goes on and takes the bread and the wine. This is my body. This is my blood poured out. How do you feel when you hear Jesus say that? What's he talking about? This is my body broken for you. What's he saying? My blood poured out? And you've heard it a million times. Yeah, well, we know this is the Eucharist. You're there for the first time. You've never heard of going to Mass. You're one of the disciples who are sitting around the table with him. And you hear Jesus saying, breaking the bread, this is my body. Or the wine, which you're all going to drink, passes it around the table. This is my blood. What's he talking about? Body and blood. Yeah, he's talking about death. So you see, again, the shadow falls over. And then they go out to Gethsemane, which is a good place being on all this. And he says, you're all going to be scattered tonight. And God, we wish he would stop. But Peter said, no! Even if I've got to die with you, no way will I ever be scandalized by you. It's very, very sad. We just wish he'd shut up. Because the saddest story ever told is going to follow. What is the saddest story ever told? Peter? The three time betrayal. It's quite awful. But we haven't got time to look at that. So I want you to notice that it's all pretty dark as we go up. And then there's a trial before Pilate, and there's the crucifixion with this is the king of the Jews. And you've got the rebukes from the passers-by, that's in verse 29. And they shout, save yourself and come down from the cross. And the chief priests mock each other with the scribes. And they say, he saved others, he can't save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross. And you think they were hoping that even at this time he might do it? Well, they might have been, we can't tell. But it's an awful moment, isn't it? And even those crucified with him were mocking. And then when the sixth hour came, what time was the sixth hour?
12 noon.
12 noon. You start at that time of year, you start at 6 in the morning, roughly the sunrise at the equinox. And so the sixth hour is midday. A darkness came on the whole earth. What's going on there? Don't say a lunar eclipse. What is going on there?
Life is living in the world.
The?
The life of the world is living in the world.
Yeah, who, well, that, yeah, I think you're right. Who pulls the switch?
God.
So it's quite clearly, as far as Mark is concerned, it's God's comment on what is going on. And there's going to be another comment in a second. And at the ninth hour, now listen to this, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. And you all know what that means in English. My God, why have you abandoned me? Now, that's the first line of Psalm 22. And some people say, well, Psalm 22 ends with a great shout of confidence. So what Jesus is doing, according to Mark, is making a great sign of confidence. It doesn't sound like it to me, frankly. And notice that that's Aramaic, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. If Mark had wanted it to be a psalm, he would have said, hello, David, you're welcome. Do you want to get, there are notes here.
Oh, thank you.
There you go. If Mark had wanted it to be understood as the psalm, ending in a great shout of confidence, he would quote it in Hebrew, not in Jesus' native Aramaic language of Aramaic. So I think we're meant to feel the loneliness of Jesus shouting out against an empty universe. And then something quite extraordinary happens. Well, two extraordinary things. The first thing that happens is the veil of the temple is torn from top to bottom. Who's done that? God, yes. Sorry, you look rather nervous as I was accusing one of you. We're not leaving this moment until I find out who's torn and it's God. So, again, God's comment on the scene, and some people read that as that's the end of the Jewish system of worship. Others say, no, it's opening up access to God. And the early Christians were torn on how to interpret that. But then the very obvious thing that happens. And the centurion, who stood over against him, so he's not on Jesus' side, when he saw that he died in this way. Now remember, a centurion, he's a professional soldier, he's been at it for 25 years, he's looking for a retirement. He's seen 1,000 crazy criminals die in this disgusting death. He's not religious-minded at all. And what does he say? He said, when he saw that he expired this way, he said, truly, this man was Son of God. We're supposed to be absolutely gobsmacked when we hear this centurion say. It's a most extraordinary thing to say. Mark is a very strange gospel. Now tell me, is the centurion right?
Yeah.
When you nod cautiously and slowly, he says yes. It is right. And isn't it strange? But we're meant to understand that. And so do you remember right at the beginning of the gospel, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Messiah? And do you remember how Peter, in the middle of the gospel, had to be rebuked for refusing to admit that the Messiah is? Well, now he's died, and now he's seen as Son of God. It's very odd. He didn't come on a white horse or a tank. The Romans aren't driven into the sea. The centurion is still alive, and yet he's admitting that Jesus is God. But we haven't ended yet. Just a few bits of light that shine. Here's one. Let's see if I can find it. Yeah. They lead him out in order to crucify him, and they conscript. Notice that word. Mark uses a very rare word for conscript. It's those of you who are following in your Bibles, it's 1521. They conscript a certain passerby, Simon the Cyrenian. So he's from Libya, North Africa, which is still a troubled territory, coming from the field, the father, says Mark, of Alexander and Rufus. Why does he say that? Why does he say, why does he waste computer ink on this apparently irrelevant piece of genealogy? Sorry? The father of Alexander and Rufus. No, do you mean a father in the sense of a priest? I don't think that's what he means. The father of Alexander and Rufus.
Would the listeners possibly know who Alexander and Rufus?
Exactly. The church for whom Mark is writing, they know who Alexander and Rufus are. It's sometimes said But it's sometimes said that Mark's gospel is written in Rome, and when Paul writes the letter to Rome, chapter 16 is a long list of people to whom Paul wants to make commendations, and one of them is to the mother of Rufus. Now, it's just possible that that is Mrs. Simon of Cyrene. We don't know. But it's a nice thought, isn't it? But at all events, if Mark's church knew Alexander and Rufus, it means that that strange African who was forced, he didn't say, oh, please let me help this poor man who's going to the cross. He would know he was conscripted into it. Something happened to him on that Friday afternoon. Very, very strange. But at least it's just a sign of hope. Here's another sign of hope. I've mentioned it already, but we've got to see it again. And there were women, God bless them, looking, sorry, I added that in, Mark, didn't I? Looking from afar, among them were Mary the Magdalene, and Mary of Jacob the Little, and the mother of Joses, and Salome, who, this is the bit I mentioned before, who, when he was in the Galilee, were following him and serving him, and many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. So we're meant to really warm to these women, because they are there, and don't ask where the men are, just to this one. Then another nice thing that happens, Joseph of Arimathea, we've never heard of him before. Suddenly he appears, and he asks for the body of Jesus from Pilate, and Pilate doesn't believe he's dead already, but he is. And so he's put in a tomb, and Mary of Magdalene, says Mark, and Mary of Joses saw where he was put. So no question, Jesus just be dumped into a mass grave. For the dogs and vultures to eat. And in fact, a stone is rolled across the tomb, we're told. Now, so now we come to the very end of the gospel, and just imagine, you're in Mark's church, and he comes in one Sunday morning and says, I've written a gospel. And he's got the gospel like this, you see, and you can see him unrolling, you can see him getting almost to the end. And you're probably thinking, well, wait a minute. Well, there should be quite a lot after the discovery of the entity. But no, this is how Mark ends the gospel. And don't go complaining, as Matthew and Luke did, that Mark doesn't know how to end the gospel. Because he does. He invented the gospel for him. So this is how he chose to end the gospel. It's only 8 verses, and then you can ask all your difficult questions. When the Sabbath was finally over, this is 16 verse 1, and you could hear in the way Mark writes the story the impatience of the women had to get the Sabbath over. Because on the Sabbath in the Holy Land today, you can't buy a thing, at least in the Jewish quarters. Mary the Magdalene and Mary of Jacob and Salome bought spices, so at last they're able to do it, so as to come and anoint him. Now notice what that means. Those women did not believe that Jesus was going to be resurrected from the dead, because they wouldn't have wasted their money. If you're going to anoint a body, it can't go resurrecting around the place until it's safely where it was last put. So they bought spices, came, and very early in the morning, now it could mean on the first day of the week or on the first of the Sabbath, so the first of our rejoicing. It's from that moment onwards that Christians made their holy day the first of their week, not the last day of the week. Sunday is the first day. Not Monday, as you thought, because that's when your legs were stuck. And they come to the tomb, and the sun has already risen. And I think that is Mark's little joke at the women. Actually, you're a bit late, girls. Jesus is gone. It's no good the men laughing at the women. Where are the men? Ah! And now Mark does something he does elsewhere occasionally. He allows us to eavesdrop on the women. They were saying to themselves, who's going to roll the stone from the door of the tomb for us? Now, it's no good the men saying, you silly women, you should have thought of that. They're not here to help. They've got another pressing
need.
They
should have asked the men along beneath the muscle.
What's that?
They should have asked the men along beneath the muscle.
Yeah, but the men had gone off in a panic-stricken puff of smoke, saying, bye, Jesus, hope you'll be all right. When Jesus was arrested, yes, chapter 14, verse 50, have a look at it, see that. And where are we now? Who's going to roll the stone away from the tomb? And they looked up, or it can mean they recovered their sight, and they see the stone has been rolled away. Who's rolled it away? So I'm not accusing you again. I know who did roll the sermon.
Angel.
It's God. Well, no, Matthew has an angel. But when it's like that, it's just a passive. What's rolled away? It's God. What we call the divine person. And then Mark makes a typical Mark comment, for it was very big. And you won't believe it. But there are scholars who say, no, that doesn't belong in verse 4, for it was very big. It belongs in the previous verse, when the women are asking who's going to roll the stone away, for it was very big. No, they don't understand what Mark is doing. Mark is saying, I want you to be astonished at what's happened. The stone has been rolled away, for it was very big. Right, meanwhile, there's an empty tomb, or rather, there's a cave with the door open. So what are they expecting when they go in? You're one of the women, what are you expecting to see? Yeah. A decomposing body, because in that climate it decomposes fast. Probably a dog, very likely a vulture, and probably the body has therefore been torn apart. So we've got to applaud these women for going in, not just because of dogs and vultures, but also because demons work in tombs. So they're very, very brave. And God help us. They went into the tomb and they saw young man. Who's the young man? Hold that question. Listen to what he's doing. He's sitting on the right and he's wearing a white garment. Who is he?
Angel.
That's where Matthew and Luke read it. I've occasionally wanted it to be Jesus. You can say that, won't you? Yeah. There is a problem we'll come to in a second, but I think you and I can probably solve the problem. I'm determined to make it Jesus. Anyway, he knows quite a lot. And they were astonished. And in Mark, and it's a very rare word he uses for astonishment. And when you use this in Mark's gospel, it's for an encounter with the divine. And he says to them, don't be astonished. It's Jesus you're looking for. So he knows quite a lot, this chap. It's Jesus you're looking for, the Nazarene, the crucified one. Now here comes the problem. He's risen, so there's the Easter proclamation. And then he says, he's not here. That's the problem. I'm sure I can solve that one day. So he's risen, he's not here. Look at the place where they put him. Now these women have a job to do. Off you go. Go and tell his disciples and Peter that he's going before you into the Galilee. Why disciples and Peter like that?
Peter
didn't betray.
He denied.
He denied, yeah. So, and the disciples, what did they do when we last saw them? Bye, Jesus. Yeah. When they promised they would be with him to the very end. So do you see how neatly and gently they're brought back on side? Disciples and Peter. Wonderful touch. We don't notice that enough. And he's going before you into the Galilee. And where's Galilee? Why, it's wherever you go to preach the gospel. Your job is to preach the gospel in York in 2012, 3 years from now, when you're graduated, it'll be anywhere. That is your Galilee, and you will see him there, as he said to you. Now, we're going to watch this. What are they going to do? And we can see that Mark is getting near to the end of the scroll, and right at the end, how is he going to finish this? Isn't he going to have lots and lots of resurrection appearances? This is the original ending of Mark's gospel. And they went out, and they fled from the tomb, for trembling and amazement held them. And that those two, trembling and amazement, was how Mark referred to the woman with the hemorrhage back in chapter 5. So it's quite a powerful emotion. And now here's the end of the gospel, and you can see Mark coming to the end of his scroll. And they said nothing to nobody, for they were afraid. And Mark sits down and said, well, that's my gospel then. What do you think, buddy? What are you going to say? Well, Mark, great, terrific. What are you going to say to Mark? He asks you, what do you think of it? Be honest. It's very abrupt, isn't it? And so even in that first century, a couple of people thought, Mark doesn't know how to end a gospel. So if you look at your Bibles tonight, I hope you are going to blow the dust off your Bibles tonight and have a good look at them. You'll see in most modern Bibles printed two other endings after chapter 16, verse 8. there's the so-called short ending and the so-called long ending, which is verses 9 to 20. And you look closely at the long ending, and it's kind of cobbled together from mainly from Luke, a little bit from John, a little bit from Matthew, and a bit from Acts. And it doesn't sound anything like the writing of Mark, and it's certainly not by him. There are scholars who hold what I call the rat hypothesis. The rat hypothesis is that the Christians who have this precious document keep it in a jar, and with what you may regard as unpardonable carelessness, allow the rats to come in and eat off the remaining verses. Frankly, if you believe that, you believe anything, but some scholars actually do hold that. So that, ladies and gentlemen, at 5 to 6, is the end of Mark's very strange gospel. Now you've got 5 minutes when you can ask incredibly aggressive questions.
One, two. The divine passive, I'm interested.
Yeah.
How is it signified? And is this something that you see used elsewhere apart from Mark?
All the way through the Bible. Earlier, you weren't here when I mentioned this, but at the beginning, he saw the heavens torn open. That's God tearing the heavens, and he's actually quoting Isaiah. So it's a regular, as you are now going to ask me, give me an Old Testament parallel, I know you are. I can't offhand think of one, but it does happen. They read that off quite easily in Mark's church. You have a question.
Jesus rested in the Garden of Gethsemane in 51 and 52, but that's like a small boy.
No, he's a young man, well done.
Young man,
yes. Extraordinary story then, isn't it? Do you remember the story? At 1450, Jesus is arrested, and they all abandoned him and fled. That's these brave male disciples who said, "We'll never abandon you, trust us, Jesus." Okay. Then 1451 and 52, there was a young man who wore a cinder, which is a linen shroud, over his naked body, and they arrested him and grabbed the cinder, and he took off the cinder and ran away naked, which in Jewish society you never do. So I think what it's doing is emphasizing how lonely Jesus is at this point. Some people think it's the evangelist. But one of my students did some research on this, and I was astonished, but he came up with the discovery that no one in the West says this before 1927. I was very surprised by this. So I don't think it is the evangelist. I think it's just Mark saying how lonely Jesus was.
There's no kind of theory about this.
Well, one theory is that it was Mark the evangelist, but he doesn't say so. He's very, very anonymous, the author of this. He stands way back from the text, and I don't think it was an eyewitness. Yeah.
Since he was a young man, Paolo, could that be also a young man in the term as well that spoke to the agreement?
Sorry, say that again.
Could that same young man be the same young man that was in the term?
Well, yeah, and what he takes off is a grave cloth, a shroud.
Well, it seems like a different cloth, but which is a different cloth of happiness.
Alas, Mark isn't telling us, but there are people who've come to the same conclusion as you. On the whole, people haven't gone with that one, but it's certainly a possible reading of it. Other thoughts? Well,
what's the significance of the young man in the tomb sitting on the right? Is that a reference back to John?
The last time we heard that phrase is in 1462, where Jesus is very silent at his trial. And eventually the high priest gets fed up and says, "I want you to tell me, are you the Messiah, the Son of the Living One?" And at last Jesus speaks and he says, "I am." Ego, I mean in Greek, which is a very, very strong statement. "And you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power." So I'm sure we meant to mention that, because we've seen Jesus wearing very white clothing back in chapter 9 in the Transfiguration. So it could be. But I mean, you and I are united. There was another, yeah.
We say Mark, and that's fine. We also say the author of Mark, which is the same thing but differently phrased, and makes room for, as you say, neater endings that have become additional.
Sure.
Any kind of editorship in liturgical context, we'd say, this is the word of the Lord. And it's kind of take it or leave it. It's true or it's not. You decide and you respond. How do we hold Mark responsibly, or any of the Gospels responsibly, as documents written by and reflected on and maybe changed a bit? And how do we hold them useful and authoritative in an educated way? Educated is the wrong word, but in a mature way.
That's right. That's a good question. One way of coping with that is to say, try this. When you open any of the four Gospels, all of which are anonymous, do you or do you not encounter Jesus there? And if you're not a believer, you say garbage. Yeah, of course it is. There's no such person. But if you do, then that's you saying, yes, it's inspired. And you can find the Jesus whom Christians meet when they break bread or listen to the Word of God. You can find him in any of the pages of the Gospel, regardless of the process by which the Gospels came to be. So you can find him in 16:9-20. I think that's quite important. So yeah, it's a very good question. So it's something, what you get over the first 400 years is a long battle about the texts of the New Testament, and to some extent of the Old Testament, particularly the New Testament, long time before they agree, at least 4th century before that everyone is agreed on what is contained in the New Testament. So in other words, what you're saying is the community that we call the church has agreed on, saying there and not in those documents you find the authentic voice of Jesus. That's the clue. So it's the community that gives the answer. That's quite important. Though. So thanks for asking that. Right, isn't it 6 o'clock? And we need to get to libraries at the moment. But I don't want to interrupt if there are other questions.
Yeah. What about the feelings of the lost Gospels about Walter Smith and 50s?
Yeah, well, you know that was being proved to be a forgery of Morton Smith.
People
still
believe it.
Oh, I know they do. The thing, you see, they often say the church has deliberately concealed these hidden or lost gospels. Not true. I mean, I've got several copies of them in English and Ethiopic. So you can read them off. Actually, a book has just been published called The Apocryphal Gospels, and you've got them all there. And actually, when you sit down and read them, and then compare them to the solid worth of the narratives that we call the four Gospels, there's no comparison. I mean, there really is solid stuff in our four Gospel stories. Whereas these are the product of overheated imagination of rather crazy Christians. So in the Proto-Evangelium of Jacob's, you've got stories of Jesus making sparrows out of mud and blowing into them and they fly away. Or someone knocks him over on the playground and he curses him and Jack falls down dead. Well, the church had a good sense. They will know, actually, thank you very much. Don't call us, we'll call you. But from time to time, lazy journalists do make a bit of a fuss about these lost gospels. But do read them and just check that what I'm saying is true. Okay, listen, I think we're going to stop. Good, thanks very much.